So good morning, everybody. I am Kathy Strandburg, and I think most of you have been communicating with me by email to some extent. Welcome. It's really great to see everybody here, to have this actually coming to pass. We've been working on putting it together and excited about it for quite a while. So I want to give you a great welcome on behalf of the Law School for New York University and especially the Information Law Institute. And the main thing I want to do in these opening remarks is thank a bunch of people. That's going to be the main thing, and then we'll just dive right into the substance. So first person I want to thank is Kyle Brennan Marquez, who's right there. Yay, Kyle. Who was my co-organizer for the conference and did a huge amount of work in getting all this put together. And I think many of you have also been in email correspondence with him. And not only has Kyle done a huge amount of work on the conference, but the sort of idea for this conference, for focusing on explanations and algorithms, really came out of conversations that Kyle and I had had over some period of time over a paper that he was writing. Terrific paper called Plausible Cause, which I recommend to everyone. It also grew out of other conversations with a lot of people who will be, either are here right now or will be here, the faculty associated with the Information Law Institute, including Helen Nissenbaum, who's right here, Jason Schwartz, Florencia Marotta-Wergler, all of the Information Law Institute fellows, many of whom are here now, and who most of whom you will see at one point or another during the day as moderators, and also through a lot of conversations that took place in our fantastic privacy research group. And I want to give a little plug for that for any of you who are in the New York area and are willing to commit your Wednesday lunch times on a regular basis to coming over to NYU and having fantastic discussions about privacy research that members of the group are doing, current events, and so forth, if you are interested in that. We just had our last meeting for this year, but we'll be starting up again next academic year. So if you're interested in that, our only requirement really is that you commit to coming regularly, because that way we create a really great group atmosphere. Other than that, anybody who's interested in privacy, big data, issues like that is welcome, and it's very interdisciplinary. So just email me and let me know if you're interested in that. Next person I want to thank, I think, is out there at the table. Nicole Arst, our ILI administrator, and maybe later on I'll bring her in here at the end for another thank you, there's no way we would do this without her. She's incredible. And also ably assisting her out there as my own faculty assistant, Ashley Jacques, and both of them are just amazing and deserve probably most of the credit for putting all of this together. So then also, I got lots and lots of thank yous, but not too many more. Members of the ILI faculty and fellows group, besides just helping to come up with the general idea of doing this, were also incredibly helpful in brainstorming the sessions, helping us identify all of you wonderful speakers, and all of that. So very grateful from that. And then also throughout the day, we'll have students from our Innovation Policy Colloquium and our Privacy Research Group student fellows coming in at different sessions to take notes for us, so that we'll be able to put together a kind of summary document of what took place at the conference, which we'll then be able to put up on the website along with all the videos and so on. And finally, in the thank yous, I really have to thank Microsoft, who provided the money for putting this event together, without which we also would not be here today. So that's, I think I've remembered everyone, I hope. The only other thing I have is just one little logistical thing, which is to remind all the speakers that in the break before your session, you should come up here and load your slides, and the moderators should try to facilitate that. And to the if anybody is not going to use a USB and you need to hook up your own laptop, definitely we'll have to figure out whether we've got all the right cables and stuff. And we have an AV person named Chloe who will help out with that kind of stuff. Okay, I think that's that's it for the intros and welcome and so forth. And now I have to make a kind of awkward transition because I'm also the first speaker. But before I start actually speaking, switch modes, I want to introduce the moderator for the panel, who is Helen Nissenbaum. And I thought it would be weird if I sat down and then Helen said, and this is Kathy, and then I got back up. So we won't do that, but Helen will introduce the rest of the panel. Thank you, Kathy.
It's a real pleasure to be sitting here today on the first of the panels called Reasons for Reasons from Law and Ethics. And I just want to say what an amazing lineup Kyle and Kathy put together. I know with a lot of help from other people, but it's quite a remarkable day just to see the range of topics and the range of speakers who are here. I think it's quite unique, and I'm looking forward to remarkable things happening in the next 2 days. So I won't spend much time on introductions and bios because the bios are all in the program and we don't have much time. So the order of presentations is going to be, as you heard, Kathy Strandburg from the NYU Law School. Next we'll have Kevin Stack from Vanderbilt Law, and finally Andrew Selbst, who is at the ISP Yale, and you're somewhere else.
Georgetown.
Yes, I just didn't see it on the program. They'll speak for about 15 minutes each, and then we'll open the floor to Q&A and discussion. Over to you, Kathy.
Okay. Thank you, Helen. So I'm just going to start to kind of kick off the day with some very kind of general thoughts about why we are worried about explanations and reasons, and particularly some thinking about this that comes from the legal perspective. So I want to talk about explanations, kind of what, when, and why, and focusing for purposes of today on, and the purposes of my remarks, on the why. Because I think although we hear a lot about algorithms and we hear about explainability and interpretability and transparency and all of these different kinds of concepts that are associated with explanation, in fact, explanation is a contestable and also somewhat ill-defined concept. We can identify at least, I mean, there are probably many ways we can talk about explanation. We can talk about at least two types of explanations that might be relevant in the algorithm context. One would be a kind of descriptive, or some people refer to this as like an account giving type of explanation, which if we're talking about decisions, would be something like, how did decision maker X arrive at outcome Y? What were the steps that happened in the decision making. But explanations can also be of a more normative type, a normative justification, which was would be something like, why is outcome Y the right result? Why is it the right result? And at least we have, I think, to think about both of those kinds of explanations when we're thinking about explanations in the context of algorithms and algorithms as either aids to or makers of decisions. And the question that, at least for me, is one of the main motivators of putting together this conference is to ask a question about when and whether we should be demanding, requiring explanations of predictive analytics results, and what makes an explanation sufficient in a given case. And so the main point I want to make this morning is that how to answer that question depends a lot on why we want an explanation in the first place. And I think that there are some useful insights we can get if we look back and think about explanations and the role that explanations play in law. So explanation is a core practice in legal decision making. It's often something that's associated with the idea of due process. And so some examples of that from the legal context are judges that usually provide either written opinions, or even when there are no written opinions, oral explanations of their decisions to parties. Rulemaking in the administrative level requires agencies to comment on, respond to comments that people make on their on the rules that they propose. Adjudicators in agency context also provide reasons for their decisions, and that way those decisions can be reviewed by judges. Of course, we don't always require explanations in the legal context either, so we have jury decisions that are made by peers and often need not be explained. We have legislative enactments, which are simply made by legislatures, don't have to be explained, although sometimes they are. They are justified by their democratic process. And then there are lots of government actions, often ones that are considered to have not very significant impact or reasons not to explain, like investigations that are going on undercover, that kind of thing. But if you think about why we find it to provide explanations when we do, and I look, go take a look at the theories that are used to talk about why we have explanation in the legal context. When I did a little review of literature and cases about this, I came up with this list of functions for reasons. And I think that this list is at least useful in trying to think about why we want explanations and why we want reasons in many contexts, certainly in legal contexts, but also in other contexts. So one that I'll talk a little bit more about in my comments is improving accuracy of decision making, but I want to talk a little bit about what does that mean, what does accuracy mean. Others include promoting fair and unbiased decision making. This is one of the reasons we traditionally use explanations. Promoting the legitimacy of decisions, decisions that are explained acquire some legitimacy. Promoting trust in decision makers. Promoting compliance with law or with rules, because explanations of decisions help people to understand how to comply. And finally, respecting people's individual dignity and autonomy, people who are subject to decisions to be treated in sort of in the legal context, we would say treating people as citizens rather than subjects. So I think these are kinds of rationales that I hope we'll sort of keep in mind in talking about explanations, why we want what we might want to get out of explanations of algorithmic decision making. I want to just take a couple more minutes to talk in a little more detail about accuracy. And I'm using accuracy in a very general sense, which I know is not always the sense that in which people use it when talking about algorithmic decision making. But I use it this way intentionally because I think accuracy involves a number of things. So if we think about it from a legal perspective, if we want to get an accurate, a correct decision out of a legal system, we first have to have a correct interpretation of the applicable law. We have to have a correct application to the particular case. And I would also argue that accuracy in the long run for a legal system depends on amending the law, if appropriate, as time goes on. So just to say a little bit more about each one of those. What do I mean when I say it's an accurate interpretation? In legal context, that means, first of all, it has to be consistent with whatever the rule or statute is. But also you have to use, because rules, laws always have ambiguities. There's no such thing as a rule with no ambiguities, no exceptions. And so any kind of legal interpretation has to have some kind of acceptable method for dealing with ambiguities. And you have to apply this method in a sort of analytically sound way. And in the end, it's virtually impossible to avoid making those decisions, at least in cases where there are ambiguities, being informed somehow by an understanding of the law or purposes, normative goals and policy. So I think all of that is part of accurate interpretation. Accurate application to a particular case means you have to have the right empirical facts, you have to use the correct legal interpretation, and you have to do this in an analytically sound way. And then finally, as I mentioned before, you might sometimes need to amend a law or rule because what you're trying to accomplish is some sort of usually democratically determined and constitutionally consistent goals or policy. But amendment is sometimes required and change in interpretation, either because there are new emerging factual scenarios that weren't anticipated at the time when the law was articulated, and changing technology is a big part of that, or because there are changes in social values and views. There are other reasons too. There can be unexpected outcomes of application of a law, a rule that was articulated, sounded great at the time. When you apply it, you somehow get unanticipated consequences. Okay, so with all these things, we think explanations might improve, will improve accuracy or can improve accuracy. Of course, they might not, so this isn't to suggest that explanations are always going to improve accuracy in this sense. But how do we think that explanations might function to improve accuracy? Well, they might help decision makers to catch and avoid errors. So when you explain something, when you sit down to write something down and explain it even to yourself, you sometimes catch and avoid errors. When you know you're going to have to give an explanation, you may be more careful in your analysis. And explanations can provide some basis for disputing decisions that to which you are the subject, and getting review by higher authority. So if there's no explanation, then there's nothing much to review. Explanations can also, assuming that they become widely enough known, help to facilitate broader critique and debate about how a rule should be applied, what its policy rationales are, whether it should be amended. And explanations trying to explain an outcome can also help to identify when a rule is giving us normatively troubling outcomes, what's going wrong with a particular rule. So how does all this deal with, I'm not going to talk much about algorithms because that's what most of the rest of you are going to talk about for the rest of the day, but just to spend a minute on how this relates at a high level to algorithms. So we often think about accuracy with respect to algorithms is we assume that we've got the right rule, in other words, that we have the right interpretation, and we assume that we have accurate and available data. And if that's right, if that's true, then if we've got the right rule, in other words, we've embodied the right rule into the algorithm, and all the data that's needed to apply the rule is both available and accurate, then some of the reasons for which we usually think about having explanations in more traditional contexts are no longer necessary. So if you have the right rule embodied with the right data and so forth, then you're not going to necessarily need explanation for catching and avoiding errors because you've got the right rule, you've got the right data. We assume the computer will properly apply it. For the same reason, you don't really need to worry about incentivizing careful analysis because the computer is going to be careful in its analysis. And if you have the right rule, et cetera, then you don't have to worry about this reason of providing a basis for disputing decisions and review by higher authorities. All of that would be true if the assumptions were valid in applying rule to particular cases. But of course, the open questions, and to me, the very important questions for possible need for explanation is what if those assumptions are not met? And how do we catch situations in which those assumptions are not met? We don't have the right rule embodied in the algorithm. We don't have the right, we don't have all the data we need, or it's not accurate. And also, of course, I want to emphasize that accuracy, even in my sort of broad sense of accuracy, is only one of the reasons that we have reasons, at least, you know, sort of in the legal context that we've kind of developed as reasons for having reasons over time. And I think that a lot of those other reasons for having explanations, which I'll just go back to the list, are also, first of all, they are very relevant in many situations where there's a legal ramification of the decision making. But I think they are also quite relevant in many other decision making contexts. We care about fair and unbiased decision making. We care about legitimacy of making legitimate decisions. We care about people trusting decision makers. And often we care about whether people are able to sort of respond to a rule by changing their behavior in a way that will comply with the rule or allow them to improve their situation, or at least we should care about that, I think. And of course, the issue of respect for individual dignity and autonomy is universal and not simply in legal contexts. So I'm going to stop there with just that kind of high-level picture of some of the things that I think do motivate our quest for explanations in context using algorithmic decision-making, and hope that one of the things that we might be able to do today during our conversations is kind of expand beyond a pretty narrow conception of, but important conception of accuracy to think about some of these other kinds of purposes for explanation. And so I'll stop there.
Wow. Okay. Great. All right, our next speaker, Kevin Stack from Vanderbilt School of Law.
Thanks so much. It's really a pleasure to be here. And I think that my remarks will hopefully follow on quite well from Kathy's. If she was emphasizing, in part, the fundamental reasons why we require explanations, I sort of want to touch on those points, but also then talk about how they're operationalized within public law. So what I hope to do in my remarks is first begin with a kind of underscoring of how important argumentation is to law, and then introduce a typology about the way in which public law requires reasons of government and public actors. And then turn back to the reasons for reasons, walk through those quickly and see to what extent the reasons for reasons help explain the regime structure we have. So let me begin with just a little thought about why reasons are so important to law. And I think that there's a way in which we can, there's a conventional view that reasons, that authority and explanation have a kind of inverse relationship. And I put a quote up here from Frederick Schauer, which gives this view, which he says, the act of reason giving is the antithesis of authority. When the voice of authority fails, the reason emerges. And, you know, perhaps that's right, but I guess I feel like it's misleading. And it's misleading in part because I think the scope for authority without reason is actually pretty small in our world. Law is increasingly understood in argumentative terms. As Jeremy Waldron writes, it presents itself as something that demands that we must make sense of it. And to make sense of it requires explanations and reasons. You know, public power on this view, and this is how David Deisenhaus looks at it, is considered authoritative only when its exercise is justified to those it affects. So there is this fundamental demand for express justification and explanation that seems like a pervasive demand in law. There are, of course, as Kathy notes, a few residual, almost vestigial areas of opacity where we don't require reasons. But I guess my fundamental point to start with is that law is argumentative, and argumentation involves the express provision of reason giving, and that's not going away. So if that's right, then it seems worth asking, what's the shape of law's demand for reasons? And I think here we could isolate, what I want to do is try and provide an account of how public law, that is, what the demands on government officials and judges is for reasons, on a couple of different dimensions. So here are my dimensions, and then I'll give you a big, put them all together. So the first is, when must reasons be provided? So are reasons ex ante, that is at the time of the action, or are reasons ex post, given later justificatory, right? When are the reasons reviewed? So the reasons also, we could ask for the review of the reasons prior to the action becoming binding, or we could ask for it ex post. Likewise, we can ask the question, what reasons are relevant to review? So here, law could demand that the action only be upheld for reasons that were originally given ex ante, right? Or it could also allow ex post reasons as part of the justification. And then finally, you know, what's the level of scrutiny? And on my chart, you'll see I have a basic, a high and a low. Sometimes we have exacting demands for persuasive reasons, and sometimes we're quite permissible. So here's how I would kind of put this together as a way of providing a typology of the way in which public law organizes its demand for reasons. So if you look at the first one, here's the police with a warrant, right? We have a ex ante demand. You have to provide reasons for your warrant before you act. right? The timing of review is also ex ante. You get a judge to review the warrant prior to the action being taken. It can be upheld only for reasons that were stated in the warrant. Post hoc reasons don't come in and allow it to be justified. And the level of review is probable cause, or as Kyle's helped to teach us, plausible cause there, so a high level of review. So that's at the highest level, the darkest of the green. So then if you move down to, say, administrative rulemaking, right, we also require, the law requires ex ante reasons for administrative rules. Frequently, the rule is that administrative rules are only upheld based on the reasons that were given to justify them. So that's this column here. Frequently, they're reviewed ex ante, that is pre-enforcement, but not always. And the level of review is, you know, roughly high in the sense of hard look review. Kind of move down, a trial court has to give ex ante reasons for its findings of law and conclusions of fact, right? The timing of review of its decision is ex post on appeal, right? And unlike rules, administrative rules, trial court's decisions can be upheld for reasons other than they said. You can uphold a trial court's decision for any basis in the record, not solely the basis the district court relied upon, and the level of review, therefore, of the reasons is low because you can substitute them. This last kind of combined category, which I'm calling type four, is there's no ex ante demand for reason giving. That's a jury or the legislature. Those reasons are constructed ex post. The timing of review is also ex post. The reasons that are relevant for review are not just the reasons that there was no reasons given ex ante, so they have to be reconstructed ex post, and the level of scrutiny of the reasons is low, in part because you substitute, the process of review is the process of reconstituting and substituting. So if that's tour and cut through the way in which public law creates a regime for reasons. Now let's just turn quickly to some of the values of reason giving, and then I'll ask to what extent do they explain the regime, and maybe also offer some insight into where the conversation that's going on today. So legal account, and these match up closely. Maybe I'm a little bit more lumpy. I lump into, but they match up very closely. So legal accountability, right? This is a requirement that reason giving or explanation provides assurance that the decision maker is focused on the right issues, right? Issues that are made relevant by law. So that's one category. It also helps to ensure that decision maker is not acting on prohibited grounds of decision, and hopefully creates a kind of disciplining effect. So this second category is predictability and to some extent efficiency. So if reason giving provides the practice of reason giving provides a prima facie commitment to act within the scope of reasons that are given, right, then reason giving provides a soft constraint and thus some predictability. For instance, if agencies state, as they do, reasons for their regulations, those reasons in turn guide the interpretation of the regulation. Likewise, when giving reasons precedential weight constrains future decisions within the scope of those reasons. So I think we think that reasons end up enhancing the legal system a kind of predictability. Legitimacy, speaking out in terms of legitimacy as compliance with the law, and here I want to turn to Tom Tyler's work. Tom Tyler, I think, provides nice evidence that people comply with the law to a greater extent when they perceive it as fair, and he also finds that a key element in their assessment of decisions as fair is the quality of the decision-making, and further that explanations augment the perception of decision as fair because they give the decision maker an opportunity to communicate their decisions as neutral. So in this sense, not surprisingly, the quality of decisions enhances legitimacy of decisions, and that involves reasoning. And then finally, dignitary interests of the audience. As Jeremy Waldron and Mashaw both argue, we have a dignitary interest in being treated as bearers of reason and intelligence, you know, thinkers who can grapple with the rationality of the way we are governed and relate it in intelligible ways to our own actions and the purposes of the state. In short, we demand that law treat us as persons for whom reasons matter. Okay, So there's a quick run through of some of the rationales for reason giving. So what I want to do in the end then is ask, well, how well do those rationales explain our regime, and to what extent can they give us some prediction? So here's my first thought is that when the interest in legal accountability is high, and the role of reasons in legitimating is high, when those two factors are both present, we're likely to see a legal regime which requires ex ante provision of reasons and also review based only on those ex ante considerations. I think that those two factors, I think they do help to explain our first two categories here. We could say with regard to police searches and administrative decisions, we have a high interest in legal accountability. We have a designated set of factors they're supposed to consider, right? As well as these are not bodies that have independent source of legitimacy, democratic legitimacy, so there's going to be pressure towards demanding ex ante reasons and reviewing them ex ante. So that, and I think in a way, actually the demand for, the extent to which reasons are doing legitimating, right, is important to this kind of outcome. That's not true. We have, with legislation and juries, they have an independent source of authority, and so we're not gonna require ex ante reasons that way. So here's a second principle is when the interest in systemic predictability is high, the regimes will treat reasons as establishing strong precedents. So here, again, I think that explains well the first three categories I have here, which is that, with regard to these first three categories, there's an interest in predictability, and so we want to have precedential weight. And of course, the weight, the strength of the prediction is going to depend in part on how strong the level of weight accorded to the precedent. And the final principle, which in of course with legislation and juries, we don't have the same demand for predictability. The final principle is to the extent that there's a dignitary interest in reasons are being triggered, the demand for reasons, whether ex ante or ex post, is going to be high. And here I think there's an important question about what the scope of that triggering demand is. So I think we typically think in law that dignitary interests of the audience in being communicated to by reasons is primarily triggered by adjudication. But if it's right that law is essentially an argumentative enterprise and that purports to be something that we can make sense of, then I think that we should also see the demand for reasons not just in adjudication but also in more general categories of lawmaking, including legislative and rulemaking style acts. And that's, I think, would be the transition to questions about algorithms, which is if we need to have law as something that can be made sense of, then interpretability and explainability of algorithms will be all the more important, not just in their application in a specific case, but maybe more generally. So, thanks. That's it.
I had said I would punish any of the speakers who went over time, and
I took that to heart.
I just wanted to mention, because that part of the room is a bit squashed, there's quite a lot of seating over here in case you would like to move to this area, but no need. All right, so we have Andrew Selbst, our third speaker, and then we open it up to the audience for discussion.
All right, hi everyone. So I'm gonna, Kevin talked about the value of explanation within the legal system, I'm sort of taking a different look to say, what is the role of explanation when law interacts with systems outside the law itself? And so, when you're considering outside systems, what are the reasons we would care about explanation in the first place? Well, this is, given this is an algorithms conference, I want to talk about inscrutability specifically. And the way I'm thinking about inscrutability, some panelists, like my co-author on this paper, Solon Barocas, will talk about this more in detail later, but primarily it's the idea that you can have an entire list of the operations of a decision system and still not really understand what's going on. That's the general idea of an inscrutable system. And you can ask whether, when the system is inscrutable, that's where we care about the explanation of what the system is trying to do. That's where we're really frustrated when we can't get to the explanation. We can ask whether the explanation is valuable as a means or an end. You could think of, if you go back to Kathy's 5-point framework of what the value of explanations were, some of them were more accountability focused, instrumental explanations, as in improving, you know, accuracy or improving accuracy of an result as applied to a particular case, but also some of them are, like dignitary interests, are explanations as means to an end. For either one, you might ask how to make an inscrutable system, you know, scrutable. And it's more than transparency. When people say we demand an explanation, sometimes they actually mean transparency. If the whole thing is blocked, what people are actually talking about is to show us what you're doing. But in the case of algorithms, there's a further step, and that's the inscrutability. So that's what I'm really focused on. All right, so once you recognize that systems can be inscrutable, we need to ask whether we can design systems to explain themselves. And there I want to talk about what explanation really entails. So explanation is actually, it's underspecified that we've heard so far already. But if you think about the question, why did the glass shatter? And you could say the glass shattered because I dropped it. But it really also shattered because it hit the floor. And it really also shattered because the chemical composition of glass is such that it's brittle. Also gravity is why it shattered, because it wouldn't have hit the floor otherwise. There's literally an infinite stack of possible explanations that you could choose from that are all valid explanations. And if you think of a toddler asking why, you can see how every explanation you give can lead to another question. And so usually when you have these kinds of explanations, you can infer context. And the context is required to understand which explanation you're seeking. So if you drop the glass, did you just break someone's china? Or are you in chemistry class asking what properties of glass makes it shatter? Without context, you can end up with an explanation mismatch. So it's really important when designing these systems to make sure you can get out the right explanations. So for that, I want to propose that there are roughly three layers of explanations that the law seems to care about. One is the outcome of an individual case. So if we're talking, well, I'll give an example in a second in the hiring context, but if I make a hiring decision or a credit decision, what is it that made that decision? Why did this thing occur? The next is the logic of the system. So what are the general rules? How do the decisions in general work? So not why did this outcome occur, but why do outcomes occur in general? And you could think of this as a full description, or it can be partial. You could think, in these cluster of cases, what's the deciding factor? And the last is system design. So this is everything external to the system, but about the system. So it's what assumptions went into building the system? What data did you collect? What were you trying to optimize for? Those kinds of questions that you can't really back out of the system itself. You have to talk to the designers. So here's an example in hiring to sort of show you what these layers look like. So you have system X, could be some algorithm, it could be a person, and it says to hire Ellen, but not Bob or Cindy. The possible outcome explanations, layer one, could be that Ellen was hired because he's a great writer. Bob was not hired because he had typos in the cover letter. Cindy was not hired because she was a woman. I didn't say all these were good explanations. But these are all individual cases, right? They explain the specific outcome in the case. Layer two. A rule that says we should hire great writers. A rule that says we shouldn't hire sloppy people. And a rule that says women should not be hired. Again, bad rule, but a rule. It could also be embedded. The biases could be built in. So it could be saying great writing is the top priority, but women aren't great writers, so we're not going to hire women. That's still a logic level question, and it's one that can be later interrogated. Design questions. So the top level is the kinds of things that went into designing system X, the goals, the biases. So because the job is communications-based, writing is really important. Or system X has learned, either through socialization if it's a person, or through some training, if it's an algorithm, that makes, you know, that women shouldn't be hired for whatever reason. But we can say outside, the system has learned this rule, and that is why it ultimately gets to these rules. So that's the sort of breakdown I'm interested in. And if you're trying to design a system that can be explainable, it needs to be able to provide these types of explanations so law can interact with it. So existing law has taken a couple approaches to try to regulate by explanation, or there are existing laws that have, I should say. And this is what I want to go through a little bit. So if you talk about regulating by explanation at layer one, at the outcome layer, the credit regulation that some of us are familiar with, called the Equal Credit Opportunities Act or the Fair Credit Reporting Act, require adverse action notices that tell you why you were denied credit or denied some, or had some other adverse decision based on your credit, like an employment decision. Layer two would be the European General Data Protection Regulation, which requires meaningful information to, meaningful information about the logic of automated decisions. I'll get into all these in a second. And layer three is when you put a witness on the stand and ask, how do you make that decision, right? It's talking about people because you can't actually get layer three. You can't get the design questions out of the black box. All right, so here's how FCRA and ECOA work, and they're implemented by Regulation B, or actually ECOA is, but. So the adverse credit determinations require a statement of specific reasons. Now, the purposes in the statute are to prevent discrimination. ECOA was passed when women were not getting loans for housing because the credit, the people giving credit thought they should be applying in their husband's names. So ultimately, ECOA is a discrimination law and said if you force out the reasons, it will stop people from giving those bad reasons. It's also consumer education. People want to be more predictable, want to improve their credit for future opportunities. And FCRA is mostly about error checking. It's, did you rely on correct data? So all these things, if you give a statement of reasons, can ultimately, theoretically, affect these ultimate purposes. The statement of reasons under the regulation has to be specific. And it has to include all the principal reasons that you were denied credit or denied something based on credit. But there's also a law that says disclosure of more than four reasons is not likely to be helpful to the applicant, which seems to have a problem if it's all principal reasons. So that's interesting. And they can't be a proxy. So if you are actually using education because you can't find income, you have to say you're using education. So in Regulation B, there's a checklist of proposed reasons. And it looks like this. And this is written into the regulation, and it's just sort of a sample form, but you know, lawyers, when they're given a sample form, oddly enough, think it's a checklist. And so when banks give you these you know, credit denials, these adverse action notices, they often try to make their answer look like something on this form. And this form has really, you know, varied things, like questions of whether you were unable to verify your credit references or have a credit file, or whether you've been foreclosed upon or haven't lived in your place long enough. So the problem with ECOA is that it's complex. It's inscrutable. Credit scoring is inscrutable. It's complex. It's based on a bunch of different factors that can add up to a total point score. So say there were eight different factors, eight dimensions to the ultimate determination, and you were given a point total for each one based on your information. And say the ultimate total was, 170 points, but the threshold for giving credit was 171. Out of the eight factors, which ones were the principal factors? Well, all of them. And which ones do you give on the statement of reasons? Well, that's harder because you can't give more than four. And so it's not clear what a specific reason for the denial actually would be. Also, the factors are non-monotonic. So length of residence might be, you know, more points during 1.5 to 5 years, but less points before 1.5, and less points or fewer points after 5 years. It doesn't make any sense. And they jump around. All the different factors jump around. It's really hard to say that this specific factor, like length of residence or even too short a time at your residence, is going to lead to consumer education such that you can improve your future credit score. So ultimately, the issue is that layer one isn't enough. You can't give an explanation for the individual case without an explanation of more of the overall principles and expect anybody to understand an inscrutable system. So this is onto the GDPR. Now there's this ongoing debate about whether there's a right to explanation. For those that don't know, the General Data Protection Regulation is a new law in Europe that regulates data protection, that will go into effect, it was passed last year, it'll go into effect May 2018, so no one actually knows what's going on with the law and what's gonna end up being the ruling. But Articles 13 to 15 all say that a data subject, that is the subject of automated decisions, is allowed meaningful information about the logic involved in the decision. And again, no one really knows what that means, but in the Data Protection Directive, which this replaced, it changed from knowledge of the logic involved. So the word meaningful seems to be, well, meaningful, for lack of a different term. And I want to look into that. So meaningful to me makes it seem like there has to be something more than a list of rules. It seems like they have to be, they specifically, the European regulators were talking about fixing inscrutability. We're taking a system and making it explainable. And can this work? Well, if the issue is that you don't know the ultimate rules and you can't interact with them, let me back up. The issue with inscrutability is that you can't wrap your mind around the rules. And so the point of the design level questions, like fairness, like accountability, are to vindicate the legal norms like fairness, like predictability. And you can't get those things by asking of the design level, like, did you discriminate? Or did you choose this particular data set thinking about discrimination? Unless you know enough about the middle layer, unless you have meaningful information about the middle layer that can prompt you to ask those questions. And so ultimately, the explanation that is required needs to be intelligible to a human, not just a list of rules, and that seems to be what the GDPR is trying to do. And there's no third layer. So if you want three layers of explanations, this is just normal litigation. This is just normal talking to the designers and human-to-human interaction. And so so if you're going to try to regulate inscrutable systems by explanation, this seems to be maybe the only way to do it, is to ask people, designers of the systems, to repair it. And I think later in the conference, when people talk about interpretability, it's really about, is it possible to repair the inscrutable systems, to make them human intelligible? And if you think back, what is the point of that intelligibility in a legal sense? It's so that we can go back and actually have meaningful discussions about whether it's discriminating, whether it's accountable for various reasons. So ultimately, credit scoring is an example of something that explains the outcome. It's layer one. The GDPR, again, an example of something that explains the logic. And it has to be more than just a system of rules. It has to be something that is human intelligible. Now, both of these I met as just examples, approaches, that we could talk about for regulating inscrutable systems. And only people can explain the design choices, the design systems, and only if they know enough to be able to interact with it. Anyway, that's all I got. So thanks.
So I'm opening the floor to questions, and it appears that we would like you to stand at the microphone because we're recording these sessions. So please.
Hello. Does this work?
Yes.
Yeah, good. I'm Mark McCarthy with Georgetown and also with the Trade Association, SIIA, down in Washington. A question for Andrew. The credit scoring is accused often of being discriminatory. It has different results for racial groups and for based on gender. And you may want to explain that by looking inside the score and saying, what's the logic? But often the way you detect that kind of discrimination is through a disparate impact assessment. You know, you don't go inside the system and try to understand what the variables are. You just do a test to see if it has that kind of result. And then you ask whether there's a legitimate business reason for it. And then the third step is there a different credit score that does the job just as well, but isn't as discriminatory? That seems to do the job of trying to control for a problem, but it doesn't give you a lot of the explanation that of what the problem might be. It just says, identify the problem and see if you can fix it in this way without going through the intervening step of explanation.
Mm-hmm. So the thing about that is, I think the business necessity defense is really where the explanation comes in. So if you do a disparate impact analysis, then it gets kicked back to the creditor to say, okay, what is your business reason for doing credit this way? And in order to be, that's a design level question in essence. What were your goals? And thus, the next question is, are they legitimate? And the only way they can answer that question is if they know enough about the system they've designed to be able to say, well, I aim to do this, you know, this is the ultimate effect, this is why the discrimination occurs, but this is why it's okay. And that's why, where the explanation really does come in.
And please introduce yourself. Thanks.
Thanks. Ari Waldman, New York Law School. Thanks for this super cool discussion. I have a question for everyone on the panel. The discussion on this panel assumed that explanation of what's happening is somehow increasing or necessary for legitimacy of the law or the algorithm, et cetera. That's true. That's one theory, but there are other approaches to legitimacy of law or legitimacy of what's going on in society. Durkheim, for example, legitimacy of the law is based on its reflection of social values and solidarity. Hobbes, the legitimacy is actually anti-explanation. You need a strong leader, whatever he says goes, and that's actually increases legitimacy among the populace. We even see that with Donald Trump supporters today. So I was wondering if you could comment on the relationship perhaps between alternative forms of alternative ways in which we have assessed or created legitimacy in law and related to algorithms, because this panel only discussed explanations, but there are other ways of thinking about that.
I want to just actually tack on, because I was thinking something along these lines about legitimacy and explanation and the role they play. Is that, let's say you hear, you know, there's a kid and a parent, and the kid, you know, wants that candy, and the parent says no, and the kid says why, and the parent says because I said so. And that's like you're authoritarian. And yet in the parent case, we may say, like, that's legitimate, because we know very well the relationship between parent and child, and typically it's because the parent is paternalistic and knows what's good for the kid. But that in other areas, that kind of authoritarian response doesn't help. And so the question is whether explanation, I think, you know, responding a bit to what you had asked, like, where that plays a role in this legitimacy question. And, right. You know, maybe law is distinctive in requiring explanation.
So, okay. Kathy, I have a couple of thoughts about that, which is actually a very good point. And I think that there are a lot of questions like that we can ask about explanations. That's only one. We can ask, even if explanations are intended to improve accuracy, do they actually improve accuracy, for example. But in that one, I think that a couple of things about that. So I think I would sort of say there are at least two other kinds of commonly acceptable sources of legitimacy. So one is just sort of, power and authority, which we do consider acceptable in some circumstances, not in others, right? So there are certain situations in which we feel that the person making the decision, I don't know, like, it's my house, so I can tell you whether or not I want you to smoke, and I don't have to explain it to you, right? So it doesn't even have to be in a political situation. So there are some kinds of situations in which we might decide that the person employing the algorithm can employ the algorithm if they want to, and it's just none of our, you know, business how they decide to do it. And I actually think that that issue of are we in that kind of situation is a very important one in a lot of commercial contexts. Because I think in the law, we generally are not okay with that, right? But a lot of other kinds of situations are a little bit trickier, right? They're commercial contexts, but they also have, you know, sort of very significant effect on people's lives. And so what is it okay for, you know, Facebook to say, you know, we're just in charge of this and we're going to decide what data we collect and it's not your, you know, none of your business? Or when is that not acceptable? Those are, those eventually become political questions, I guess, because we might be regulating them. The other arena where I think it's very important is in the area where we're talking about expertise. So, you know, we might, if we're thinking about the explanations that we want out of, let's say, a medical system, right? I might not care that this system can explain to me, as the patient, everything about, you know, kind of what's going on. But I might, because I might be willing to rely on the expertise of my doctor. I might care if it can explain it to my doctor, though, if, you know, the doctor can understand it. So I think it's right, exactly right, and we should be thinking about when we care about which kind of explanation, when we care about which form of legitimacy. And I just want to note, because the second time I've heard Helen bring up this parental example, that, you know, even in the parenting case, though, we normally don't treat adults that way. So, you know, and even with children, we, good parenting, we expect that as they get older, we provide them with more explanations. Why? It's because we want them to be able to make good decisions themselves and to be able to comply, right? We want kids to be able to comply with the rules and not just be arbitrary. So even in the parenting context, I think we see some of these same reasons for reasons showing up.
Kevin? Yeah, I think it's a terrific question, too, and I guess I agree that there are other grounds of legitimacy outside of explanation. I think at least thinking about public law and the context in which we require we want an account of legitimacy and justification from our public officials, I'm actually amazed at the extent to which it's argumentative, right? There are places where we say pure democratic authority is sufficient. Those actually seem relatively small, and even in those contexts, they're subject to more argumentation. So it seems to me that if you were to ask what the sort of background demand of legal authority is, I view it in argumentative terms. And if that's right, then I think it will have implications for how at least public actors are using these kinds of sources. Now, I think there's some terrific questions about how you operationalize those kinds of demands and whether we want to have just decision-based, logic-based, or design-based explanations. But I think that the, but anyway, so thanks for the question.
Yeah, thanks. It's a great question. I kind of want to answer in a way that I'm not sure is directly responsive, in that I don't know that I want to talk about legitimacy so much as if we accept that there are certain legitimate normative goals that we desire to achieve, like fairness, they may be achievable outside of explanation as well. And so when I was talking about considering whether we actually use explanation as a tool, if it's not possible, there might be approaches where you compare different systems and just look at which has less disparate impact. And we might not know why, but we might say, well, we care about having less disparate impact. Let's use a system that has less. So there are other kinds of maybe ex ante regulation that doesn't rely on explanation quite the same way liability does, where you can, you know, promote certain normative legal goals outside of explanation. And that's one way that explanation is not certainly the be-all, end-all.
I'll take both of the questions together.
I'm Foster Provo from NYU. Hi, everyone. Thanks. So, so a question that really Andrew's presentation led me to that I've thought a little about on the technical side, but it seems like it has much broader implications, is what are the implications for what would be the default decision, right? And so take credit, to tell you what I mean, take credit scoring. So you could have one situation where the default is we don't just give everybody credit, You know, you could, you need to like show that you're worthy of credit, as opposed to, sure, everyone is worthy of credit unless, right? And so in the, if you're asking why were you denied, why was I denied credit, right? It's a very different situation depending on what the default decision is, right? If the default decision is we don't give everybody credit, it's like, well, there's a, you know, a whole ton of different ways that you could have been, made yourself, you know, sort of worthy of credit, and you haven't done that, right? Whereas if the default decision is, sure, everyone deserves credit, you know, then there is some specific reason why you were, you then were not worthy, right? And so I wonder if, yeah, if you could comment on that. Thanks.
Next question.
Hi, I'm Lauren Hansen. I'm from the Data and Society Research Institute. And I was wondering for the panel what you see as the relationship between explanation and accountability. So we talked about explanation as a way of teasing out the underlying value systems and logics that are informing these algorithms, but in cases where those values are deemed to be insufficient or incompatible with social goals, or where the algorithm isn't meeting up to the like ideal logics of it, what kind of mechanisms you see for making changes and for getting the algorithms in line and holding people accountable?
Great. Andrew, you can take one or both of the questions.
Sure. Well, I'll take the one that was addressed to me. So what are the implications of the default decision? I think it's a great question. And I think to put it in the framework I was talking about, these you can think about these as design level questions. They're default in that we don't tend to think about them. But if we made them not default, we would just give the reason for them. And so we could, similar questions are, what are the ultimate goals of your system? What are you optimizing for? If you're a bank, are you looking to maximize profit, or are you looking to get the most likely customers to pay back your loan? Those are two different metrics. And so the question of, you know, whether our default is everybody deserves credit or not is one of a series of design questions which we can all ask, like, what's the right answer? And I think you're absolutely right in your premise that this will affect the ultimate goal, but this hasn't, those debates don't have a lot to do with explaining the system. They're just normative questions that debate in society has to hash out, I think. So that's that.
Kevin, do you want to? Yes.
Oh. You know, on the thoughts about explanation and accountability, certainly we want explanations. Part of what the reason we want explanations is to ensure that decision makers are making decisions based on valid and not invalid reasons and not taking into account, and part of the explanation function is flushing them out, which I think goes to, I've enjoyed reading the papers, and you know, the extent to which the algorithm is interpretable and offers, there's some mechanisms. I think it was Nick DePoulos, Dikopoulos's paper, hits this point a little bit, so we can wait for some further things. So I think that there's going to be real pressure on the level of explanation and interpretability of the algorithm to provide that functioning of that accountability mechanism as a first thought.
Yeah, maybe I'll make a little comment on both questions. So on the accountability question, I have this sort of a same issue with accountability that I have with explanation, which is that it seems like a very broad sort of term. So I think that the ways in which explanations relate to accountability are sort of many and kind of going down the list. So explanations can improve accountability simply because we're requiring someone to explain, and then we can later hold them accountable. You gave this explanation for this decision, now you're making another one, seems totally inconsistent with the last one you made. That sort of accountability. But I think explanation also helps in accountability from a kind of self reflection perspective. As I'm writing out an explanation, I'm thinking like, oh, does this seem right? Does this make sense that I'm making this decision? So I feel like many of these just sort of reasons for explanations are also ways in which explanation relates to accountability, or might relate to accountability. Because I think I mentioned this when I was talking, but I think it's important to realize that explanations are one mechanism that which may or may not always be effective. On the point about default, I think it's a great question, and it actually is a place where explanations should be helping us detect those sort of defaults, like what is our default assumption, but might not always, because we might just start from the default and explain from there. But at least I think explanations can be one way to help an outsider looking in to do what you just did, to say, wait a minute, there's a default issue here that this explanation doesn't really seem to be acknowledging or is hidden in the way the explanation is given. So.
Okay, well, we have a few more minutes, and if nobody, I think Duncan is about to.
Yes.
Okay, Duncan.
Yes, Duncan Watts from Microsoft Research. So I have a question about inscrutability. And reading some of the papers and listening to the panel this morning, there seems to be a sort of unstated assumption that inscrutability is primarily, if not exclusively, a problem for algorithmic decision making. And therefore, we should be subjecting algorithms to this sort of, you know, special treatment, as if we've sort of solved that problem for human systems. But I think actually, you know, if we look at the literature on, you know, implicit biases and cognitive neuroscience, and you know, not to mention our everyday experience with airlines and insurance companies, that lots of human systems are inscrutable, right? In fact, even individual decisions are probably inscrutable. Like, we don't actually know how our brain is processing the signals that are coming in to help us recognize language or solve problems or come up with the decisions that we come up with. And so I think, you know, I agree with all of the, I think all of the reasoning about inscrutability is helpful, but I just, I find it sort of a little puzzling that this is a topic that is only sort of coming up in some sense now that we have algorithmic decision making, whereas in fact it seems equally relevant to every other type of decision making system.
Can I respond to that?
I'm gonna go down, because this will be the last. So I'm gonna start with Kevin,
okay.
Kathy, Andrew.
Okay. Thanks so much for the question. I think that it depends on here what sense we're talking about explanation. If explanation is more causal, there's many aspects of everyday life, all aspects of it, in fact, that are inscrutable. I think that we have a consistent demand, though, for explanation in terms of justificatory reasons, and justificatory reasons are then made public. So it's not. So I think we still are consistently asking in other aspects of law, legal regimes, the extent to which there's justificatory reasons, and making sure our justificatory reasons match up to a certain extent with motivating reasons. So I think yes, inscrutability is a problem elsewhere in law, but I think it's managed in part by the requirement for justificatory reasons, and we leave aside what are the true causal reasons.
Yeah, so I actually think that, in fact, this issue of inscrutability way predates any worry about algorithms. And in fact, what did I do when I was trying to think about the reasons why we might want reasons? I went to law, which has been engaged in a process forever of rendering human decisions to be not inscrutable, right? I mean, I think, in fact, that's where we get all of our kinds of justifications for why we think explanations might help. Explanations might help because inscrutability that there, and it works at various levels. Inscrutability of those three people got together behind closed doors and they all decided what we were all, you know, what the rules we're all going to have to live with. It helps with that kind of inscrutability. But I also think that just the process of writing explanation helps, you know, even with the inscrutability of why did I make this decision myself. I can catch myself in biases and so forth, and I think that's actually part of why we do require explanations. I think there is an interesting question, which I won't go into because other people have written about, but to what extent in the legal system should we require people to give their actual reasons, you know, like what really motivated them? To to what extent do we just require them to give an explanation which is considered appropriate from in the legal context, right, which may not have any, not really necessarily reflect the decision maker's actual reasons? I think that's actually a very interesting question and quite seems quite related to this inscrutability point.
Andrew, last word.
Yeah, so thanks. I mean, my presentation may not have reflected it, but I'm the explanation critic or skeptic on this panel. And I would say that, I completely agree with you. And this is also the reason law is terrible at dealing with unconscious bias, because law has this fiction that humans can explain themselves, and it is entirely based on this fiction. In some cases, we might be able to write down reasons, but even judges writing down reasons might not actually realize that they're not writing down their real reasons. Unconscious bias is a thing. But, so for me, that means we have two sort of intersecting projects. One is to discover what in law is based on the human limitations that construct this fiction of explainability, and why we might be forcing algorithms to explain themselves because we're trying to conform to law where law is itself flawed, and separately, how to get algorithms to explain themselves as if it were, or if it's a good. And I think those are two things that algorithms can help teach us about where the flaws are in the legal system that are based on human limitations. On a more concrete level, though, if you just say, why are we requiring more of algorithms than of humans? The answer might be because we can. And so quite aside from all these theoretical questions about the limitations of human reasoning, of legal reasoning and its fiction that humans can explain themselves, we can't, see the code in our brains. Like, we're inscrutable and there's no way around it. Whereas with algorithms, there might be. And so why not require more explanations if we find explanations themselves to be valuable?
All right. I think that this panel has led us to a great start. We have 15 minutes. Please return at 10:30 for the second panel of the day. Thank you so much. This is great.
Thank you.